Hello, and welcome to another episode of Sci-Fi Reality Check. I'm your host, Beth Johnson, here with my co-host,
Franck Marchis. Hi.
And we're from the SETI Institute, and we are here to overanalyze Star Trek Strange New Worlds. This time we're here for Season 2, Episode 5, Charades. There will be plot discussion, so, spoiler alert, make sure that you've seen the episode.
Yeah, it's always better to see the episode before analyzing the science of the episode.
Right? Exactly. So, if you haven't seen it, take a pause, go watch that on Paramount Plus and come back to us and watch us overanalyze some science. All right. Franck, should we get into this?
Yeah, what happened in this episode? Brief summary, reminder?
Oh, brief summary. This is the episode where Spock and his fiance are going to have to do the whole engagement ritual with her parents and
shuttle.
And her mom does not like him. And to add the layer of comedy to it, he and Nurse Chapel get into an accident in the shuttle, and highly advanced interdimensional aliens heal him, but out of confusion for the fact that he has two different DNA instructions, they make him entirely human. Just not really good when you're about to go into an incredibly emotionally calm Vulcan series of rituals. So, that's the plot.
That's the plot. Okay, so I think we should talk about this encounter with this extraterrestrial species.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of like this idea of, and it happened a lot in Star Trek, of a Star Trek crew meeting a species which is very different to ours.
Oh yeah.
Like they are, they live in the subspace apparently. Somehow they took a decision to leave the planet.
Mm-hmm.
And now they are kind of this entity which are not corporeal.
Mm-hmm.
And the main difficulty here is to communicate with them. So what's the name again?
The name with the K. Oh, man.
Is that a bad question?
It was,
I have it written in my notes, but I forgot their name. It's going to come back. Okay.
Yeah, so I just remember that the individuals went by colors. So, like, the first one that they encountered on the end when they were dealing with the fallout of the wreck was yellow.
Yellow.
And then
they talked to blue.
Later, they talked to blue.
And they called it Kerkhoff.
Kerkhoff. That's right. Thank you.
Okay. So, this is an interesting conversation that we have at SETI and in the search for life, is that one day, maybe we are going to find life which is very different to our lives.
Mm-hmm.
So on our planet, you know that we share a common DNA.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, there is a lot of similarities between human beings. We are 99.999% identical, genetically speaking. But we also share a lot of similarity, genetically speaking, with other species, even fruit, vegetables. Anything on this planet comes from the same tree of life, and it started with the same type of chemistry, so the chromosome, the amino acids are the same. We are a carbon-based species.
Right. Hydrocarbons, very, very, very important in life on Earth.
So let's assume that we have a species which is either appear in a planet which is different to ours.
Mm-hmm.
So a gas giant, for instance, or something like this, or a species that has evolved way more time to evolve.
Mm-hmm.
What's going to happen is that they will be very different, meaning that they may not have the same carbon-based chemistry that we have, but they will also, if we think about in the term of Kardashev civilization, like if they're extremely advanced to the point that they manage to harness the energy of a galaxy and so on, maybe they're not even living anymore in the same space continuum to ours.
Right.
And that's what we have in the Kerkhoff here.
Right.
They are not in our space-time. They don't have the same perception of time. and space. So that's where they appear and seems to disappear. And the conversation will be extremely difficult with them. What are you going to tell a species which doesn't have the same conception of space time?
And I think I have to say that one of the things that kind of stood out for me was the fact that, like, as far as communication went between us and them, when they initiated it, they were perfectly fine. You know, it was perfectly fine. They had their communication, but they also seem to have a very strict set of rules with how they interact with other civilizations. And I feel like it's sort of like they have their own prime directive.
Exactly. You know, that's like, what I was about to say.
Yeah, yeah.
And their prime directives is very difficult for human beings to understand. Mm-hmm. Like this idea that they are basically connect with you, they fix you, but then they don't want to have anything to do with you. Probably because they consider that those humans or the species that we are in fact like not that advanced and not interesting compared to what they can do.
Yeah, I mean, and that was one of the things that, like, the whole subplot of why Nurse Chapel is interested, because she's working on this medical archaeology. And so she wants to understand what would have happened, could have happened to the civilization, how they advanced, what their technology might have been. And so to actually encounter them and find out, oh yeah, no, they are definitely far more advanced than we are. That was kind of amazing. And sort of watching her go through the whole scientific process.
Yeah.
Because she's trying to, the science of the show here is that while all of this comedy ensues, is going on with Spock and Pring's family and everyone else, it seems, Nurse Chapel is trying to scientifically figure out how to reverse what the Kirkhoffs did to him and make it so that he is back to being his normal human Vulcan hybrid self and not just fully human, because he's basically going through an emotional puberty,
yes,
which is causing him to be
teenagers.
Yeah, which is causing a lot of very interesting issues, and especially it's not something that you want when you're dealing with a future mother-in-law who doesn't particularly like
the idea of having a species contaminated with human. Because
that's
the problem, in fact.
Yeah,
more than anything else,
she doesn't like the human. She doesn't like Amanda. I mean, let's be honest. She's fine with Sarek. She's fine with his politics, but she doesn't like Amanda. She doesn't like the fact that Spock is contaminated, and so that's pretty difficult to live with.
The good transition to talk about the second part. I think this idea of an extraterrestrial species, when we connect with them, they will have a different culture, mm-hmm. different ritual. It's going to be very difficult for us to communicate with them, not only to say hi and so on, but to go beyond that. Like we can see on Earth, despite the fact that we are all human and we come from the same very small species, in 10,000 years, we evolve in 100,000 years, we evolve in a very different way. I mean, we know the Western world has this kind of values, money and so on, for instance, but there is a lot of other civilization on our planet which does not value money, does not think the same way we do think, and our rituals are extremely different from ours, and we don't understand them, and they are human.
Mm-hmm.
So they have the same genes, same chemistry. Now imagine we meet aliens coming from another planet, and we have to explain to them birthday, Christmas, the importance of high school and all of this. Like, what makes us human is our ritual and our culture.
Mm-hmm.
So we're gonna meet these aliens and we are going to have to explain to them our culture,
mm-hmm.
but also be able to embrace and understand theirs.
And I think one of the things that causes the conflict is it's also a question of how open-minded both sides are. So you can want to understand Vulcan rituals all you want. If the Vulcans don't want you to understand them and don't want you there, they're not going to share the information.
Yeah.
So that's true just between humans and you know, in a larger context, even more difficult if you don't even have like baselines to sort of ground yourself in the reality of being a human. You know, okay, so we all kind of understand that. We know, like, what it's like for our species to be born and raised and a lot of the similarities that we all go through. But to take it to a completely different species, a different race, you know, these alien life forms, now sometimes, even when you have all of these bipedal, you know, two-eyed, similar-looking species, there's still a lot of diversity in how they thought, how they approach things, how their planet may have evolved, yeah. And the sort of situations they had to overcome to become a civilization. Yeah.
Yeah. So, for instance, to go back to the Vishal, so there is this moment where he has to hold this super hot pot,
yes,
and show no emotion because, they base their entire civilization on the fact that they stop having emotion, but they don't stop, but they try to refrain having emotion because their emotions are apparently way stronger than the emotion that humans have. So they realize that if they want to evolve, they will have to stop this.
Mm-hmm.
So they built an entire structure around this, a mm-hmm. ritual, basically, and a culture where they cannot have emotions.
Right.
They look like robots when they speak.
That was a fun scene.
That was a fun scene, right?
Do I really sound like that? Yes. And this is a theme that keeps coming up in the series, and I know we'll talk about it in the next couple episodes too, but just this idea that, you know, Vulcans are supposed to be a certain way, and when they don't match that, everybody's expectations are kind of broken.
Yeah.
And so it was... I thought it was a really good character story. So showing sort of like the character of Spock on a different level, his relationship with his mom, his relationship with his fiance, his relationship with Chapel. I mean, there was a lot of interpersonal communication going on there, but the real story, I think, is still Nurse Chapel's attempts to reverse the process and to understand the science of how they did it. And eventually having to sort of, you know, give in and beg them
and to give it to her.
Without
explanation.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's basically like, please. and, you know, having to justify it, you know, why do you need this? Why is it important to you? Why should you be the person
deciding that you want him to go back to the way he was?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Because for those aliens, he was imperfect.
Mm-mm.
Probably. I don't know. We don't know the details, but
no.
There was something that they saw in the genes that make it that he was not perfect. So they have to, when they rebuilt him, they rebuilt it purely human. They could have chose to rebuilt it purely human.
Well, and I think some of that is the fact that she was with him. So therefore, and there's the whole little tiny mention that comes later on that he diverted the shields to protect her for a variety of reasons. But their takeaway from that was that she was important to him, and therefore he must be more like her.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the important part of his DNA was the stuff that matched hers. So they went on a lot of assumptions. Again, assumptions, not necessarily
so
a good thing.
This is interesting because this is an advanced civilization, and they truly believe they can take decision like this for a smaller, mm-hmm. less advanced species.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bit like what any advanced civilization would probably do.
Yeah.
If we meet aliens which are way more advanced than us, they may want to change us. They may want to, they may say, okay, you know what, you're not that perfect. So we're going to change your gene, you're going to send your political system, we're going to change your planet at large. Are we ready for that?
I don't think we are.
No.
No.
So that's maybe a reason they're not here. Okay.
All right. It's an interesting thought that, you know, again, and I think this comes down to some of our audience can chime in here in the comments, but, you know, if they're out there, one of the possibilities is that they look at us and say they're not advanced enough for us to reach out to.
Exactly.
And that's kind of what happened here was, you know, they fixed the problem that the aliens fixed the problem that they caused, but they still don't want to interact with humans. They're like, nope, you're not ready.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Franck.
We'll see you next week.
Yeah, we'll see you guys for the next episode. So check back in. And if you have any questions on the episode, feel free to leave them in the comments below. Do all of the things like share, subscribe, follow, all of those. And we'll be back with the next episode. Thanks, everybody.